end of the day, that's the target. Now, in India, you know, when you're talking about India, most of the big corporate sectors are family-owned. Almost always they're family-owned. And they work extremely well. And the founders stay at the helm of affairs for a long time, unlike in many countries in the West where the founders actually have to leave or forced to leave. But the statistic, I don't have the statistics with me, but I read somewhere that when you have the founders working with you, the vision continues. Because when the founders started something, they started with a vision. And maybe the paradigm of the, there may be a paradigm shift in the vision, but you still need to have the vision. You also need to have new blood, because sometimes the founders may be outdated. And then how do you keep people in your office? How do you keep people in your organization? Do you look for people who desperately need job and therefore they'll stay with you forever? Or do you look for people who may be very good in the jobs? So you also need to look at the long-term and the short-term investments in human resources, and the balance is not easy. So when you're talking about creation, now, all creations may not necessarily be inventions. All inventions may not necessarily become innovations. And it is not necessary that every invention will become a marketable product. Or sometimes something is not an invention, which is not even an intellectual property, may still be an excellent innovation and may be converted into a commercial product. The idea, again, is knowing what to protect, what not to protect, what to keep it a secret, and also knowing what to put in the market. Now, the most important problem most innovators face is there are too many people watching. There are too many people around you. There are sharks, there are vultures, there are parasites, there are pirates. And sometimes, some of the innovators may also play one of those roles against other innovators. So that's very important to remember. So the one thing that happens is that when there are people after you can be sure that you've got a good property. Even in India, when you have, you know, pre-grant opposition, it's my experience, you know, handling oppositions for many years, defending as well as opposing. It's very, very rare that a bad patent is opposed. It's always an excellent patent with excellent commercial potential that is opposed. And when you have a situation like our patents law, where you have pre-grant opposition, where you can file a pre-grant opposition any time before grant of a patent. And in spite of the fact that we have a high court judgment which says that serial oppositions are not to be encouraged and no opposition can be filed after the patent is granted, but that doesn't really mean anything because that's what the law already says. The problem is before the patent is granted. I have had at least four situations in the last 4 years where every time against the invention, opposition is filed, and on the day you go for a hearing to defend that opposition, another opposition is filed. And so on and so on. And we'll never get a patent on those. So that is the problem. So what do you do with a situation like that? Now, I've also, you know, did a bit of study about a lot of companies that have really succeeded. Talked to the few. Well, most of the companies who really succeed do not start with great assets, but because they have the ability to evolve. Just take a pharmaceutical company, for instance. So years ago, when I was working with Pfizer, now I visited their facilities in Groton, and they took me to a lab where there was just one tiny cupboard which had actually blockbuster drugs, and a whole room full of drugs which failed, and which failed during several phases, right from the commercial, from laboratory trials, even up to the phase two trials. And 90% of the preclinical drugs fail. But still, then what happens? People innovate. And they spend so much of money in innovation. They have the courage to do that because they'll find that one molecule which will be a blockbuster. And they continue investing, and also people continue investing in those companies. So that's because they synergize for the market win and not just because of the technology demonstration. So that's very, very important. So we did a study about those companies. You'll find that why some of these companies really, really succeed. They are committed to a vision, like I said, not assets, and they need to evolve. You all remember that dinosaurs are dinosaurs, but they never really survived. They became extinct because they couldn't evolve. Look at some of those companies like Pfizer. We know them for anti-cancer drug. We know them for the Lipitor. Pfizer also makes skin creams, baby ointments, and 100 other products. Gilead, antivirals, Hepcera, you know, hepatitis, most of retroviral drugs, hepatitis C, hepatitis A virus drugs. And Gilead, again, had the courage to play according to the market forces. Many of the, almost every one of the patent applications, despite being granted patents in every part of the world, faced unusually heavy oppositions in India. In spite of that, Gilead had the courage to license their technology, and many, many Indian companies licensed their technology on a small royalty. Genentech, again, look at the recombinant DNA. Now, we also have companies like Actelion, Swiss company, not a very old company, but really working with a great vision and have been taking on companies like Eli Lilly. We also have first-generation Indian companies like Lupin, Cadila, etc., who are willing to fight against big multinationals and work, and because they have a vision and a target at the end of the day. Like Praveen said, in another context, target is most important. Let's go beyond pharma. 3M. First, what we call Scotch tape, then the glue that does not stick, the post-it. But look at their portfolio. It's amazing portfolio. Had the courage to diversify, have the courage to go, and courage to invest, because they have vision beyond their initial products they started with. Something, you know, Tokyo Shoshin Kogyo started with electronics. They also had an electronic rice cooker in the early 1950s that was a blockbuster in the consumer products, and they became Sony later. Partnership, he said, cross-licensing. Praveen already mentioned that. Gilead licenses to 9 Indian companies their HIV patents. Well, not patents, they're still applications. They're under appeal. Novartis partnered with Themis Medicare for their diclofenac injections, and they're marketing them all over India today, and they're having excellent response. Although the patent's not been granted on them yet. And more often than not, we only see the companies, you know, what they really need to face, the challenge that they need to face, is that the drug that hits the market may not necessarily what they started the lab with. And they got to keep filing, keep innovating, keep filing patent applications, then file another one, and then you file a Marcus claim, and then you file a salt, which is really, this really works well, and then you got to keep investing in that, the hope that one of them will succeed. Then unexpected litigation. So we also need to have a lot of insurance. The litigation budget is something that's impossible to budget. You know, every company knows that when they budget for litigation, they're actually just putting a figure. They're never ever going to stay within that figure. It's going to exceed several times fold. When you have multiple litigation in multiple jurisdictions, and like I said, particular jurisdiction in India where it's not very expensive to litigate, but the prolonged litigation and also litigation when you start, when you file a patent application, you are starting from there. And like if you have a good patent and a good invention, then you're litigating forever and forever. So unfortunately, you know, when you have a, where you have a situation where you have an excellent invention which you have to defend for the rest of your life, and that costs a lot of money and also uncertainty. Look at Galaxy 7, you know, look at the adverse publicity that it had because a couple of batteries exploded. You cannot carry them in your hand laptop, you cannot carry them in your flight, you cannot carry them in your suitcase anymore. And look at the happiness that Apple would have had because of that, you know. So every time, you know, something like this happens, there's a competitor which is really, really growing very, very fast as well. So you need to be able to weather the storm. You need to have like a summit up, vision, different for people from different backgrounds, courage to face failure, and courage to innovate all the time, and people with complete intellectual honesty to innovate. You need to really be sure that you don't reinvent the wheel. You should have the courage to failures, which are always inevitable. In the laboratory, you never start with a certainty of success. Commitment to deliver on subsequent or change business plans, which will happen all the time. You know, market forces, the political forces. Today, we are talking about a national IPR policy. And we are talking about the more favorable IP regime. But we must remember that it's not change in the law, change only in the thinking. Tomorrow, if there's a new government, there may be new thinking again. So therefore, again, we will have to be able to then change the own company policies and change the business plans, etc., and come with the new business plans have people to articulate new business plans and credibility to actually get backers within the company and outside to invest in them. With this, I'll finish. Thank you very much for the patient listening.